What are some of the motivations for publishing, whether it's sensitive or not? Why are we all sitting in this hot room trying to publish our data? Well, we're trying to make it freely and globally available so that we can enable the use of the data for not-for-profit decision-making, education, research, and public benefit. And ultimately, reduce the risk of damage to the environment and help safeguard a sustainable future. Doesn't that sound nice? That's why we're all here, right? So, coming back to the definition, what is sensitive data? Why are we addressing this? Well, it prevents a lot of people from publishing their data if they think it's sensitive. So, first let's try to understand what it is and if it's going to prevent us from publishing, okay? Sensitive data is that which, if it is released to the public, could result in an adverse effect on what it is that you have in your data. An adverse effect on the taxon, on the rhinoceros, or on the elephant that it is that you have in your data set. There are some problems, though, in trying to come up with this, what is sensitive data. There's no universal list where you can look and say, this is sensitive or not. That's because what is sensitive in one area might not necessarily be sensitive in another. In fact, what's a weed or a pest in one species could be considered sensitive in another. So this is a pretty complicated problem, right? So how do we assess sensitivity? Well, this was identified as a huge challenge in the GBIF network going back some years. And so a review of the existing approaches back then were taken in 2006. And a couple of years later, a best practice guide was released to the public. And you can see what that document looks like there. And this is something that you can take back to your institution as a set of guidelines to help the researchers assess whether or not their data is sensitive and how best to publish it. And the link is provided there so you can download. So what are some of the criteria for assessing sensitivity? All right, so quickly. The risk of harm. So assessing whether the taxon is subject to a harmful human activity. We're talking about white rhinoceros in South Africa, for example. Well, those are being poached near to extinction at this given moment. So there is a huge risk of harm by humans. The impact of harm. Assess the sensitivity of the taxon to the harmful human activity. Third, sensitivity of the data. Assess whether the release of data will increase it. And four, decision on release and category sensitivity. It's kind of like taking all those considerations into account and then making a decision. The guide helps you walk through each of those and categorize your data's sensitivity. So here are the categories. Category one. This is probably for a species of high biological significance that is under extreme threat, like the white rhinoceros. So in this case, either the species will not be provided at all, or they will only be released, specifying that they appear inside a large region, such as a county or a watershed. Category two, so this is for species that are still classed as very, very sensitive. In this case, we are going to denature our georeference information to 0.1 degrees. So, it's a little harder to locate that species given our original data. So the original data that specifies the exact point gets denatured. Another word for denaturing your data is generalizing your data. And we're going to do that for 0.1 degrees in this case. category three, you know, the amount of denature in our records is getting less and less. Less and less again. And so there's a nice summary table here that shows you those different categories. And again, you could use the best practice guide to basically categorize your data into one of these categories, given those criteria you mentioned earlier. So I'm going to go through this as quickly as possible. It's the guide that we want to do. Is it just geospatial data that can be considered sensitive? Can other fields in your data set also be considered sensitive? So what happens if you removed or denatured your georeferencing, so your coordinates, but you haven't removed the collector, collection dates, and collection IDs? Well, potentially somebody could go into your data set and trace the activity of that collector over time and make a general assessment of where that researcher was and, you know, basically figure it out anyways, what they were trying to hide. So, names of living persons, maybe if they're afraid of being persecuted by animal rights activists or something like that, maybe you would hide that. Locality information. So it's not just the latitude and longitude. That's my point. There's other fields that you have to take into consideration when you're generalizing your sensitive data. And you need to use the best practice guide again to help you do this. So, what are some of the important principles that we need to remember when we are generalizing our data? Well, what's sensitive today might not be sensitive in the future. So we always need to include a date for review of the sensitivity. Two, we should never alter or falsify the original record. We are generalizing what gets published, but we always want to retain the original copy ourselves. And we can always give the original copy to researchers that ask nicely and that agree to comply with strict terms of usage. Number three, you have to tell very clearly why you are generalizing the data. So explaining that the data are sensitive, explaining what the sensitivity category the taxa are, the precision of the data being made available. So if you denature your georeferencing by 0.1 degrees, you should specifically say that in the metadata so that users of your data coming along, well, it doesn't impact their results because it can have a huge result impact on the analysis. And you should also indicate the position of the original data stored so that they know, okay, well, your original data wasn't that precise to begin with, so I'm not going to bother asking you for it because I need something that's, you know, precise to 3 meters, one certainty, for example. So all that information you should put in. So why would we still want to publish sensitive data, albeit generalized? Well, here's a couple of reasons I'll give you, okay? It will alert other data custodians that in your neck of the woods, you regard that taxon as potentially sensitive. Remember what I told you? In some places, a weed is just a weed. But in other parts, it could be considered extremely rare and sensitive. If you don't let the world know that you consider this as sensitive information, how is anybody going to know? Okay? And second, you can alert users that they should take the sensitivity into account when publishing the results of their analysis. So, I've already kind of told you the consequence of not documenting the generalizations, you can have a pretty big impact on somebody, for example, running a climate modeling algorithm, but you haven't specified that you generalized your data. It can be very misleading, and it can lead to misuse. So, it's one of these overriding principles to publishing sensitive data. All right, so that's it for that presentation.